Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Kelly Morningbull. I am from Bigani Nation and I work with the Calgary Public Library. I just want to welcome everybody into the space today and thank you for joining us. We have some really great speakers and I'm very honored to be in this space and to hear and to listen to what is going to take place. Before we begin, I am going to pass it off to Nina Bixi, our elder and one of our special guests, to open us up with an opening blessing.
Okay, thank you, Kelly. Okay, Moksia. Ah, just take. Thank you, Kelly, and to all those that are going to be listening on this presentation from myself and Alvin. As always in Blackfoot country, you start with a prayer. That way, good feelings and good thoughts prevail and are transmitted now through technology. So I'll say a prayer in Blackfoot to all of you that we have a good spring, a way better spring than we had last year because of this virus, and all of us to hopefully meet each other in person and buy each other coffee or donuts, whatever's best, or both. So now I got symbols for all of you. I will not be not those. I'm not going to eat the I got to look at the mark just to pick it out. Spike will come stop at symbols. Oh, Mook's action, it's a mocking nuts. Mukinstisika, kita po taki. Ay kakinika, mukaso kitista to, umianika sukape, tapa muipe, kanomianstitopi. O kinisto, monskan, noctu tamut spinna. Noctu to atsumushka, kindness krakku. O nukuno atsumushka, kanomianstitopi. Ay o kagis, pumukinan is chipato. It's our Kaya. Akita Kaya Nikak, my nag sesksim. Og no, six case of his chakquist kag. Nakaya kapwa puts maltine, Utakuin, the Masakita massaps. Six a car, Kaina, Pikanyam sky pikan. Organic skate skin, exakita massapas, motu, Pikanatu kakquigs, Okanaka oka. Ai kaagis pomukina na kimukina. Ei kun sta pokemon stopina ni se paato pil. Ani kaak sukaa bio kaapina kus. Ani sukaa bina kokot pipuka. Oki kipitaaki. Ani kaaki taaka tumukina kuukoi. Okat sukka mukina na kaaksi ku. Kimma tuukina no kuosa sok mukse. Aksoksi sinot pina ni sisto. Okin ka napi sukin aksin nakita ma ko. Kim mukin na ni spum mukin na ni sipato. Okin ka gas ko chikim mo chi spinan. Okin ka no kita ko ta chi mo chi spinan nakita mi. Ita pi ta mi ksim mo chi spinan. Amos ka sipato pio. Okin nakita mi pu spinan. Amos ka sipato pio ka kuka man sto okin kita ki ko komikiso. Oge xahkum meitopi. Ita mita päikset kaistina kuin stumikaat. Oge nukana omiaan sitä piiksi tai kutsii kuin sinun enää kiinni. Oge no xahkui. Ennä kaikki. Ita päikä on jo kaikki omiaan sitä piiksi. Kimmukin näin skummukin. Oge nää piuasen kaamotaan. Aksi päätä piuksin. Säästävät se maan kaamotaan. Thank you, Kelly.
Thank you, Nina Bixi. That was really I always enjoy sitting in these sessions with our own members from the Blackfoot Confederacy. I think it's so important that we share our information and our stories from the people from this land. And so thank you again for opening us up. So before we begin, as part of protocol with the opening blessing, I'm also going to give a land acknowledgement just to recognize where we are here today in Mohkinsis. So in the spirit of respect, reciprocity, and truth, we honor and acknowledge Mohkinsis and the Treaty 7 territory and oral practices of the Blackfoot Confederacy, the Siksika, the Kainai, the Piikani, as well as the Eathka Nakota Nations, Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Wesley, and the Tsuut'ina Nations. We acknowledge that this territory is home to the Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3 within the historical Northwest Métis homeland. And finally, we acknowledge all nations, Indigenous and non, who live, work, and play on this land and who honor and celebrate this territory. So once again, thank you for being here today to hear this wonderful presentation called Bison and the Birds. Before I'm going to pass it off to our facilitator, John McFall, who is president of Nature Calgary and a member of the Bird Friendly Calgary team. John?
Well, thank you, Kelly, for the great land acknowledgement, and certainly for Dana Bitsky for his great blessing that we have to start off this presentation this evening. So welcome, everyone. My name is John McFall, and I'm a member of the Bird Friendly Calgary team, also president of Nature Calgary. So I welcome you to attending this meeting tonight, a celebration of birds. I will have the pleasure of emceeing the proceedings for this evening. I hope some of you actually got out today to enjoy another nice day of spring, despite the bad weather we've been having the last couple of days. So when I was out this morning, I heard a bird singing in my backyard. It was a robin. And it's always a pleasure not only to see the birds, but to listen to their voice as they come back into our landscape. Reminded me of a writing that the naturalist Henry David Thoreau wrote 163 years ago. And it goes this: each new year is a surprise to us. We find that we have virtually forgotten the note of each bird. And when we hear it again, it is remembered like a dream, reminding us of a previous state of existence. What happens is it that the association it awakens are always pleasing, never saddening. They're reminiscence of our sameness hours. The voice of nature is always encouraging. And this certainly is a recognition of the blessings of Naha, our Mother Earth. In that regard, tonight's presentation is the second of two webinars that provides an opportunity to explore and learn about the Indigenous perspectives on reports of birds and how they're celebrated and protected. Last week, we had Brad Kiesberg of the Miami Tribe of Oklahoma describe his work with the Audubon Great Lakes Project in and around Chicago. Tonight, we will have the pleasure of listening to the wisdom and knowledge of Nina Bitsky and Alvin First Rider, who will share their about birds from a Blackfoot perspective. So tonight, I'll just give you a little idea of the sort of proceedings, and then we'll move further on into the meeting. So I will first be asking Kathleen Johnson of Bird Friendly Calgary to express or to describe what Bird Friendly Calgary is and what our mission statement is that we're trying to achieve. I'll then introduce our guest speakers and then ask Kathleen to provide a traditional gift offering for them. And then the presenters will be able to provide their presentation, and then we'll go to a question and answer period. And to ask any questions you may have regarding their presentation, just write them into the chat box, and then I will relay as many as I can to our speakers for this evening. So just follow that protocol, and we'll be able to answer as many questions as we can. So now, I would like to invite Kathleen Johnson, who is actually a co-founder of the Calgary Migratory Species Response Team. It's a team that goes around in the spring and fall around the buildings in downtown Calgary to look for and pick up any injured birds or even perhaps unfortunately dead birds that strike our buildings downtown. So she's very active in that, and also a driving force behind Bird Friendly Calgary. So Kathleen, please let us know more about the Bird Friendly Calgary.
Wonderful. Thank you, John, and okay, everybody. It's lovely to have all of you here, and many thanks to our friends at Calgary Public Library. Thank you, Kelly, and many more in behind scenes that you can't see right now, like Zorica, who's helping us. We're really grateful for your assistance. We're very pleased to tell you about Bird Friendly Calgary. We're a fairly new group, so we're a volunteer group comprised of individuals, with many of us representing a number of conservation groups, other groups, as well as supporters who've joined together thanks to the invitation and support of Nature Canada. Our hopes to have Calgary officially certified as a bird-friendly city, perhaps one of the first in Canada ever. This is part of a brand new national strategy by Nature Canada, and their goal is to have 30 or more cities certified as a recognized bird-friendly city by International Bird Day on May 14th, 2022. So the strategy is a response to the fact that in the last 50 years, North American bird populations have dropped by more than 25%. This amounts to 3 billion birds that have been lost. And so the work that the groups are doing together are important to hopefully conserve more birds, because the more we can help with birds, the more we can help with our environment altogether. So a lot of gratitude to the people who are coming together to do this work. And some of the groups that are recognized or represented on our team, there's the Calgary Migratory Species Response Team, which John mentioned, Nature Calgary, Calgary Biodiversity Advisory Committee, the Calgary Wildlife Rehabilitation Society, the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, Calgary Centre. We have representation from Mount Royal University, Ed and Sandy Cross Conservation, great friends at Calgary Parks, the City of Calgary, Blood Tribe Land Management, you're getting to meet Alvin tonight, as well as Mustaki Institute, MD of Foothills, and there's more as well. So we're just really grateful for the participation of everyone who's coming together for this important effort. So we do want to thank Nature Canada and Environment and Climate Change Canada for providing our team with the funds to stage these two events, as we reach out to gain the wisdom and the traditional knowledge of Indigenous communities, learn how we can take this knowledge to better protect birds, and in respect to all of our efforts together. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Kathleen, for a great overview of Bird Friendly Calgary and what we're hoping to achieve over the next little bit of time. So that's much appreciated. So what I'll do now is I'll just introduce our first our two speakers we have tonight, and then we'll go through a little bit of a gift ceremony to honor their presentations, and then they will be able to then provide their presentation. So our first presenter will be Alvin First Rider. Alvin is an environmental technician with the Blood Tribe Land Management. He received an Associate of Applied Science degree in Natural Resource Management from the Blackfeet Community College, which he followed up with a Bachelor of Science degree in Environmental Science from the Salish Kootenai College. A special note, Alvin was placed on the United States National Dean's List for Academic Excellence during his time at the Blackfeet Community College, which is a marvelous achievement. Alvin applies his traditional ecological knowledge and understandings of land use processes of the South Saskatchewan ecoregion to coordinate environmental, archaeological, and traditional land use assessments. His passion is to make an impact in protecting our environment. Species at risk protection, alternate and renewable energy, environmental law, and migratory birds are subjects of great interest to Alvin. Our second presenter we are honored to have for tonight is Nana Bixky, who is a respected elder of the Kainai First Nation. Nana Bixky is currently a fourth year PhD candidate at the University of Lethbridge, pursuing a doctorate in philosophy, majoring in cultural, social, and political thought. He has received a Bachelor of Arts and a Bachelor of Education degrees from the University of Lethbridge, and he received his Master's degree in Administration and Supervision from Gonzaga University in Spokane, Washington. Nana Bixky served on the Blood Tribe Council twice, 1980 to 83, and then again in 2011 to 2016. During that time, he established the Kainai Ecological Protection Agency. He was a principal, vice principal, and teacher at the Kainai High School. He serves on the Old Man Watershed Council and participates on the Crown of the Continent Roundtable Leadership Committee. The Nabitsky is a much valued participant in Kainai ceremonies and events. A particular passion of his that I find very interesting is to research and establish Blackfoot names on the mountains and lakes of southwest corner of Alberta. He is a rancher and an avid outdoors person and was a gifted athlete in his younger life, including track and field, football, and as a rodeo performer, including performing at the Calgary Stampede as a bull rider. So he comes with a variety of expertise, and there's many, many more things that I did not include the introduction tonight. So those are our two speakers for tonight. So we're looking forward to their presentation. But before we do that, I would like to ask Kathleen to come on to offer a traditional gift for them.
Thank you, John. One of the things that I love about the team that's come together with the Calgary bird-friendly effort is that we all share very similar values of the importance of truth and reconciliation. So speaking for myself, especially as a person who wants so much to learn how to better support truth and reconciliation and put words into action, and also as someone who loves wildlife, I'm so grateful that you're here today with us, Nina, Pixie, and Alvin. For far too long, we haven't listened and we haven't heard. Today, we are here to listen and we're here to hear you. We're going to put our own opinions aside for at least a moment and hear what you have to say and hear what you have to share. And we're going to learn from you. We're so grateful. So on behalf of the Calgary or Mokinsis bird team, to thank you and to honor you, we have for you a satchel of tobacco and a gift which was lovingly handmade in Calgary at Moonstone Creation. We wish that we could pass these to you warmly in person. However, because of COVID, they're in the mail. Hopefully you've received them by now, but we do, we just want to honor you for being here. And we just feel so honored to have you and have this time and this knowledge that you're sharing. So with a warm hug of welcome, Mike and Alvin, please know how happy you are that you're here with us virtually. And I hope you know how pleased we are that you're here. Thank you.
Okay, that was really appreciated, Kathleen, for your honoring the guests. And we will now ask Alvin First Rider to present his presentation.
Okay, Kathleen, were you able to share your screen? Okay, yeah, I've been having technical difficulties. I haven't been able to share my screen for some reason. And I hope this it works.
Right. Okay. You need to move it forward and I will do my best to be a good assistant here.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Anako, Natoyen Nisaksen. My name is Alvin First Rider. My Blackfoot name is Holy Brings Down or Holy Descent. I'm from the Kainai Nation and I'm descendant of Abskapi Pikani. I work for Blood Tribe Land Management as an environmental technician, and I'm happy to share the work that we are doing down on the Blood Tribe and how designating Calgary as a bird-friendly city will contribute to the overall landscape of Blackfoot territory. Next slide. The Blood Tribe is located approximately 2 hours, plus or minus a few minutes, depending on how you drive. It's south of Calgary, located in Blackfoot territory. Calgary is located in Blackfoot territory. The Blackfoot Confederacy consists of three tribes in Alberta and one in Montana. And the Blood Tribe in Calgary share the same fly zones and eco zones and eco regions. Next slide. On the Black Chai, we're specific to birds. We're our ecological monitoring consists of migratory bird survey point counts. The map below shows our different point counts throughout our Ini buffalo range on our north end of our reserve. It's all native prairie grassland, and it's a transition zone between the mixed grass and foothills fescue. And there we're trying to identify critical habitat that will help conserve corridors that will help the connectivity issues that are on the landscape from fragmentation, and overall enhancing stopover habitat for our migratory species. Next slide, please. This is one way we collect data is through our acoustic recording units and trail cams. We're able to monitor continuous from a site that's continuous, and we're able to compare and contrast. The map in the middle, we designed that specific study of ARUs to look at disturbed lands versus undisturbed and try to identify species diversity and richness. So yeah, that's it's a good way to familiarize with bird calls. We've partnered with ABMI, Alberta Biodiversity Monitoring Institute. They trained us on how to upload and then utilize the ARU and trail cam features. Next slide, please. Here are just some photos of trail cams that we, on the north end, on our near our Ini range, and one of them, the one in the middle, is it's in our Ini range. The one it with the pelican, can you zoom in a bit? Well, the one with the pelican is surrounded by agriculture field, and the buffer system is pretty much non-existent, but it's a very heavily used wetland, and being able to identify the use and what species are there will help us be able to recommend buffers. The photo in the middle is a ferruginous hawk. I think he's landing, hunting on something. And then the last photo is of blue herons, and it looks like they're mating or they're doing some kind of dance. But yeah, that just some the opportunities trail cams offer you. Next slide. This was a neat photo. I thought it deserved to be by itself. It's of an American kestrel, and it has either an insect or an amphibian. And he's going to perch on our trail cam, which is pretty awesome. Next slide. Well, that leads me into our data on the Ini buffalo range. We've been monitoring the occurrences of species through point count, and we've been able to identify the species that are using that area. A wide variety of species, but they relate to Calgary, and we probably share the same species through migration. The majority of species on the north end is meadowlark, and then it just goes down to the sparrow species, vesper sparrows and clay color. And yeah, we have a wide variety of species on that area. Next, please. The next few slides are just photos of just rare or incidental observations. And so these are of beta eagles and raptors of the Blood Reserve. The bottom photos of a northern harrier that had a really unique color pattern. And then the two top photos on the left are of beta, and then of Swainson's hawk. Next photo, please. This is Swainson Hawk, who will they're always perched up on telephone poles or light poles around Calgary, and a very unique species to watch. And during harvest time, they just wait for the combines to go through, and then all the vermin they hunt. It's a pretty neat time to watch in the fall time. Next slide. These are just the incidental observations of American kestrels throughout the reserve. The top two little raptor birds that are fierce, and then of a prairie falcon and okay, next slide. These are our little birds, tsetse. We have a crown, white crown sparrow, clay-colored sparrow, the two on the power pole. The one in the middle in the vegetation is a vesper sparrow, and the other one is a clay-colored sparrow. I just want to make a comment on community-based monitoring and how being able to document photos and upload them to community-based monitoring sites like allaboutbirds.org helps contribute to scientific observation, and it helps identify patterns and migration patterns. Next slide, please. This is a upland sandpiper who are, if you take a drive out beyond city limits, they'll be hanging out on your fence posts, and their calls are pretty unique. And they will do a distraction display to try to attract you away from their offspring, which I find pretty neat. Next slide. These are waterfowl of the reserve. Double crested cormorants, blue heron are everywhere, and northern pintail. This poor northern pintail, they had a small ephemeral pond in an agriculture field, but they nested and their offspring survived in that little, and it goes to show the importance of those little ephemeral ponds and how we need to create little buffer systems to help them. Next slide, please. These are just shorebirds of the reserve. The first one is Wilson's snipe, rainmaker in Blackfoot, willet species, and then there's the marbled godwit and American avocet. Very unique shorebirds that have unique displays and calls. And if you get a chance and you're by a wetland, try to identify them. Next slide, please. This is just a bird that throughout last summer, he hung around the reserve by our high school. And these are just some photos that I captured that were a few weeks apart. And it goes to show the resiliency of birds and the strength of their spirit. It's like that one leg, he's able to survive on that one leg, and it doesn't even fade him. He just continues through his day. Next slide, please. The connection between making Calgary a bird-friendly city and the overall landscape is in the top right corner. The highlighted areas are important bird areas of Canada, and it goes to show how close the urban landscape is to those important areas that are high stopover use areas, high migratory bird areas, and being able to alleviate some of the impact that Calgary has as a city will contribute to the overall landscape of Blackfoot territory. Next slide. So Yeah, this is just a map of the migratory bird routes, of just a simple map. There's more extensive ones, and through community-based monitoring, we're able to define them even more on the ground through observation. So yeah, I just wanted to, I got something. Calgary is part of the bigger landscape ecosystem that can be categorized into main ecoregion. Mogensis is an important corridor for the many species of the animal kingdom. The diverse landscape in it, the historical movements of species and of Blackfoot. Mogensis was a wintering ground, and being able to use that as an important movement corridor and able to protect the green spaces in there will help the migratory species. Next slide, please. This is the Kainai Holistic Management Plan. The plan was developed with community involvement through elder engagement, and was very well done. Was completed by Wes Olson, and it's a very good plan. It's based in ecocultural restoration of getting Ini back on the landscape. And through that, through our monitoring, we'll be able to identify the changes and impacts of bison reintroduction on the grasslands. Birds have evolved utilizing Ini, and birds such as like the cowbird's original name was Aksi Ini, which was buffalo bird, which shows the relationship that the species relied on the movement of bison. But bird species will use their dung to attract insects. Burrowing owls have been known to line their nests to attract the beetles. Bison hair has an important nest insulator for both small-bodied migratory species and above ground nesters such as cup nesters that are exposed to the elements and water. Bison movement they roll in the ground or through wallows, or the disturbance they cause on the land, it creates ephemeral ponds that contribute to the migratory species. They help seed dispersal through their hair. They're broadcast seeders, their hoofs are aerators. They help plant the seeds. And then in the winter, they're part of this landscape. They help other ungulates through their movements as a herd. They're able to clear areas that other ungulates can't, which exposes the grassland that's underneath. They're a missing element on this landscape that is needed, in my opinion, and it will help heal the land once they start roaming, and once they're allowed to start interacting. Sharp-tailed grouse, they depend on species disturbance, a species that we've recognized culturally. Next slide, please. This is some community work that is being done. The website was created by William Singer, Knoppy's Garden, based through the work that the Kainai Ecosystem Protection Agency is doing collectively. The top photo, Nopi's Guide and the Guide to Culturally Important Plants. That's a link to a document that a group of knowledge holders has created that is shared for the public, that is a very good resource for people. And then the Buffalo Treaty. It's just the foundation of reintroducing Ini back on the landscape. And just wanted to read out the passage from there. The purpose and objectivity of the treaty is to honor and recognize and revitalize the time immemorial relationship we have with Ini. It is the collective intention of we, the undersigned nations, to welcome Buffalo to once again live among us as Creator intended by doing everything within our means. So we and Buffalo will once again live together to nurture each other culturally and spiritually. The Buffalo Treaty was signed September 24th, 2014 on Skapi Pikani. I believe there was 12 nations that signed, and there are a lot that have signed on. There's a map on there that has the individual nations. And, next slide, please. These are just some apps and websites that we use that help community-based monitoring, Nature Links and Wild Tracks. Nature Links is the app, and Wild Tracks is a website that we use to upload observations that contributes overall to the overall provincial monitoring database. iNaturalist and All About Birds are international, that contribute internationally to the conservation world. And I use all of them heavily during field season. And then these are just my references. We use the Bird Migration Survey Protocol by Alberta Environment and Parks, Blackfoot Online Dictionary. There's the website for Nopi's Garden, and then other references. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Alvin. That was a great presentation, and very interesting to see what is able to be accomplished once the landscape has become whole again, particularly with the introduction of Ini, the buffalo. So now I'd like to call upon Nina Biski for his presentation.
Is this mine or Alvin? Is this your map?
That's your map.
Okay, yeah. Okay, yeah, I just wasn't sure because it looked too pretty. Okay, it's gonna eat so much. Alvin, gee, awesome. When I got on council, I wanted to kind of get a group going that would be always, continuation of environment. And so far, I don't know if there's over 40 of us on our group. And it was formalized in 2012 when I was council, finally got approved by council to be first an agency, now it's an association. And I think we're about to have 8 environmental summits, and COVID 2020. Because of COVID, we didn't have a virtual or in-person conference, and I think we're slowly working on one to maybe have a virtual conference June. And we've averaged over 300 delegates, all over, native, non-native, young, old, scholars, non-scholars, traditional knowledge, wisdom people. And, you know, and the networking has been tremendous. And as Alvin has mentioned, in 2014, I was one of the official, or not a person, but first signatories to the ENA Treaty in 2014 in Browning, Montana. And now I think we have already 40 or 50 people or tribes, I should say, that have signed the treaty, and it's gone into Mexico and up north, and a lot of the Treaty 6, Treaty 8 people on board, and some also have brought their buffalo back the same time we brought ours back about 5 weeks ago. And so I guess this map, I just wanted to show this for those that don't understand or never kind of quick looked at our traditional territory, and it actually goes right into Wyoming as the stories, and there's Blackfoot teepee rings in Yellowstone Park, and then traditional territory all the way up to North Saskatchewan River, and actually it kind of goes beyond the continental divide from the stories. So you know, you could see mountain range here, you know, the Bighorn Mountains, the Rocky Mountains. And when you talk about the E&E and the birds, go ahead, Kathleen, switch it to the next picture. Yeah, and so these are some of the areas that, you know, Spiti, Napi's Playground, the Crow's Nest Mountain, you know, Crow Lodge, Valley Buttes, Chief Mountain. These are traditional, and some of them even have older names, you know. And so it gives you an idea of where Blackfoot people, where we're coming from, and the basis to our points of origin or stories of origin. And, you know, the Milk River, you know, Napi, the old man, and the Bow River, so it kind of gives you sort of a landscape. Imagine if the buffalo were here, they'd be all over that bus beyond. But, you know, when it comes to the bird species, you know, this is where their domain is. Imagine 150, 160 years ago, as Kathleen mentioned, they wouldn't be flying into buildings of skyscrapers. And, you know, it'll be interesting how many birds, you know, have, you know, kind of, you know, how many species of bird numbers we have. Is it dwindling, you know? And I know they do bird surveys in as we call it, or Waterton, at different parks, and you know, there's different bird watchers group. I think those people that kind of used to trivialize all these people standing in the fall or spring or whatever different seasons with their binoculars, the bird counters are going to get recognized, because they're the ones that are going to tally with different formulas what kind of birds are still here. And it's like the buffalo. If we take out one, two, or three species of birds, it has a chain reaction to the earth, to the insects, to the flowers, and on and on. And so, you know, bird watching is not to be made fun of or ridiculed. I think it's a necessity at this time of what all is happening in Blackfoot territory and beyond with different developments. Okay, next picture. This is Chief Mountain, and it's looking towards Police Lake. And I went through there, actually it was warmer last week or the other week, and just took a drive through the Police Lake highway. And, you know, Chief Mountain, Ninastaku. And, you know, you could see the nothing against ranching, nothing homesteaders, all that. They're there now. But imagine, you know, before the buffalo were killed off, imagine all that, seeing buffalo in the range, plus all the birds and the wildlife. And so survival of ranching and wild animals. And I have friends up right in this territory, this place here. And, you know, so I kind of wanted to slowly get into, you know, birds are much more than just the word birds. Chief Mountain has a legend where Chief Chikum had it out with raven. And that's, many of our pipe bundles come from that story. And raven, and thunder was being cruel at the time to animals, to human, to mankind, to all species of birds and animals. And so raven had to figure out how to get the edge over Kristikum, the thunder. Thunder was using lightning to strike down. And then so raven figured out, well, I'm going to attack thunder when it's warm, because you cannot create lightning when it's warm and it's sunny. And so when the match was over, thunder promised that he will not harm the people, the species, and in turn, the people would be gifted with medicine pipe bundles. And so previous map that I showed, Crow's Nest Mountain, the moved over to that mountain, and that's why it's called Crow's Nest Mountain. And if you look at it, Crow's Nest Mountain is right here by Livingston Range, and the Chief Mountain is over here when they battled. So they settled on these, and so now today's name is Ninastaku, but that's where the thunder being, the thunder bird, you know. So this is an old story. And what transcended now that we use now in physical form, from the metaphysical to physical form, is the bundles and the pipes that go with the ceremonies today. So Umkai still moved to Crow's Nest Mountain. And so those people that have gone through the pass and even Lethbridge, they call it Crow's Nest Trail. Now you know it's not just the name of a trail and it's catchy, that there's actually a Blackfoot legend, an old story why it's called Crow's Nest. And from there they in turn called it Crow's Nest Pass, Crow's Nest Trail, etc. But many people now, tonight, right now, will realize it's not called Crow's Nest Trail for nothing, that there's actually a story behind it. And so we're talking about birds today. Well, you take the thunder bird and Tshikum and the Umkaistu, the raven, having it out. So imagine we go beyond Western science philosophy or so Western philosophy. We have our own Black philosophy, and at times, and it's getting very evident that, it's coming to a point where we're starting to disassociate. And I was introduced as doing my fourth year doctorate in philosophy and majoring cultural, social, political thought. I would like to change that as a doctorate in Blackfoot philosophy, but that will make heads spin in the academia world, in which I think I am spinning their heads. But I am Blackfoot, and I have a hard time really understanding Western philosophy, especially when I do ceremonies. I can't switch my brain back and forth, being deep embedded in ceremonies and the Blackfoot thought and spiritual realm, and to absorb Western philosophy it's coming to a close, and each year I'm having a tougher and tougher time accepting Western philosophy. So somebody just asked a quick question. Right here is the Livingston Range, and we call those Panikdans. Right around Crow Lodge in that area, this side, that's where all the mining is happening. And I understand today there was a rally in Calgary. Indigenous water protectors. And so Old Man is the headwater. So these mountains where it says Livingston Range, and I may be a little bit off topic, but nobody's going to tell me no dust is going to be going into the headwaters, because most of these streams all go into the, Old Man River, and that comes all the way downstream. And so I may be a little bit off topic, but even with that, the waterfowl, the birds, there's going to be a disruption of all animals, including birds, if this coal mine, you know. And so never mind just flying into the buildings at Calgary, this is going to be another devastation. So to me, I think that's another presentation which I would love to be called back on and just talk about animals and the coal mine that is being proposed. And obviously there's no understanding or very lack of it by those people that are wanting to go forward with this coal mine project, you know. And, it's a sad thought, you know. Imagine if these mountains were removed, the birds, these fish, the four-leggeds, the keystone species will all be, lose their homes and their migratory routes, just elk, bighorn sheep, the birds, the nesting, and even the insects. You know, imagine pouring coal dust on the anthill and different insects, you know, those animals are not going to survive, you know. So I guess I'd like to move on before I get too hot under the ears here. You know, so next picture. And so going back to, and this is Sweetgrass Hills. And from Chief Mountain and to Sweetgrass Hills, there's some birds similar, familiar, the same bird families, but more or less as you move away from the mountains, you start seeing the prairie species, sauky beaks. And I've heard that from the old people, prairie birds, you know. When you grew the sauky beaks and these tuxi beaks, mountain birds. And it doesn't really matter what the type of bird. And so all these, the hoodoos, and I don't know what hoodoo mean, you know. And this is Sweetgrass Hills here. They're also all the birds and plants and animals here. And imagine again, if this was a picture 150 years ago, all the buffalo. And as Alvin mentioned, you know, the buffalo being the best caretakers around in terms of vegetating the earth and the grass and all that. And the buffalo never overgrazed, never. They were very, very conservation conscious in their own way as Iñi. And so I wanted to throw Sweetgrass Hills another story of, Gatuyis and Gatuyis and all that. I could be telling legends all night. Gatuyis and then how he defeated, the other person there. And then he went successfully and then freed up the people. So it's almost like freeing up the people to live better, you know. So that's another story. Come and visit me. I'll tell you legends all night. Anyways, moving on. This is Waterton. And this is about a month ago with all the snow. And this is, we call Bakhtuwaksikimi. And different stories, but the general story I've heard is the body, the lake created by ice and rivers and streams. Bakhtuwaksikimi. There's some elders like my mother doesn't call it Waterton Lakes. And somebody Oh yeah, this I was introduced as changing the names, you know. These hills here, I've heard two names, or Adunoxus, the mountains here. And so the names coming back here, and Vimy Ridge, Sakimopi, you know. And so these are names that I've talked to other elders that I found in my research. And Mount Cleveland way back here, Ispitapuye, one who's the tallest, Ispitapuye here. So when you take all those natural names, Bachtumxikimi and the bird names and the animal names, the Inin, it's one complete story, one complete cycle of survival. How the fish, the insects, the birds, the animals, the wolves all depend on each other for survival. And once that's taken out of away, then something, there's a domino effect, you know. And the thing is, with global warming, I hope we continue to see ice caps for millions of years, because if we don't, this Bachtumxikimi, Waterton River, and on the other side, this is Valley River, it's going to go dry, you know. And so the bull trout is starting to, the numbers are going down and the other types of trout and some of the bigger fowl live off those fish. And if they have no, fish to eat, then they're going to have to go elsewhere. I have seen the red-tailed hawks here, the eagles, and then across this hill there, Cameron Lake, I've seen a lot of eagles diving in and catching fish. And so we cannot upset anything, but through inventions, through modernity, through logging, oil, all that, it's going to create a disruption. Next picture. And so this is one of the lucky spots in Bachtumxikimi. I took this picture last September. The fire went around this little valley right by Mount Bowerman and Lost Mountain in Bachtumxikimi, Waterton. That was the only green space left. And I was riding, I saw a few numbers of birds there. The other parts, which we'll see, all was burnt. And it was so quiet because usually when you're in the mountains, in the park, you hear bird chirping. We didn't. I didn't. And, it's almost like, I think animals even left where it was safe to get away from the fire and smoke. But I think they're slowly going back in there. But I kind of, looking on the ground, tree trunk, unless it was too early in the morning. We started at 9:30. I didn't see any insects, you know. And so the bird count in Waterton, and I'll be talking to them, what's still there, you know. So this is Mount Bowerman, this ridge here, and right next to it would be, the Lost Mountain Ridge, you know. And so this is the only valley that was green, and the rest was burnt. Continue. I just wanted to show a picture. That's my house over there. And this is the Valley River, spring runoff. And so I get a lot of birds here and from around, and there'll be another picture. And a lot of birds, sparrows, the six, as we call them, the small birds flying around here. And, you know, I like seeing, but I'm seeing limited numbers of birds. I'm really wondering what's going on here. And like somebody, my grandfather's both side used to say, some kind of wintered on the prairies and the river valleys, and others went back to the mountains when it got hot. And just like Alvin mentioned Wilkins to say no sail through there. Also the bird winter ground. And then from there they scattered, went back to you know, what is now known as Banff and all over. And so the river valleys, for those species of birds that need to nest, not on the ground when it's covered in snow, the popular trees are not regrown. All this across the river, this little edge, that was, there's trees there, but the old trees could be over 100 years old. The poplars, or some would say cottonwoods, but we call them umxikaniksim, the big dry bark tree. And apuxikaniksim, the rough dry bark. Apuxikanikim mix. So that's where I live. I didn't want to enlarge it because you guys will start looking through my window. So I just made it small. Yeah. Anyhow, continue. Okay. This is a log picture. This is my, and I'll share a quick story. This is where I came into the world, right? In this log house, there's a local house here, some of it, our house in the late 50s. And this whole bend was all tree line. And through floods and erosion, it was thick with brush. And so my grandmother, this log house was built in 1934. It used to be way up south. And you could see the geese. These geese never left. In fact, right now as I speak, they're still down there. You'll see these as I stood on top of the hill, right below is our swimming spot. And right across the river, between these two trees, there used to be more trees. More trees. And my great-grandfather, Mike Blood, used to walk or ride across, and he'd sneak, tie his horse to these trees across the river, and he would look at the prairie chicken doing their dance in summer, early spring, and he kind of knew what time they danced. The prairie chicken dancing, all that, and he'd be there for hours, and these birds, the prairie chicken would start dancing in the morning, and then gets hot, and they all fly away, and then he'd come across, and he would tell us the story, how many danced, you know, like that, if three danced, one danced, and I think he was telling us the most he saw dancing was, I think he said eight, and he used to walk over there, and the grass would just be kind of flattened when they're dancing, and sometimes as if they're waiting for each other, one would dance, then another one, and then stop, and another one. And to me, if those video camera and like, you know, we're talking 1930s, 40s, and when I was a kid, 50s, because I used to wonder what he would do, and I was just a little kid. So this is where I came into the world here. My grandmother, Bruised Head, my great grandma brought me into this world. And this was all trees. Now, the reason I also brought that, include this story about my great grandfather, Apspinogopi, his Blackfoot name, seeing these prairie chicken dancing. And he was just, you know, the effect it had on him, he was just kind of bubbly and cheerful. He said that he saw that he had a good show, like a good show, a good demonstration. But my great grandmother had polio. And all thick with trees. And this is where I'm going to slowly talk about. I'm not a Ghana scientist. No. I don't want to be called a scientist. I'd rather be called just a natural knowledge person, whatever. My grandmother or my great grandmother used to tell weather by birds. So we go beyond science, the world of science, and to us in my own family, my own lineage, and plus other people on the Blood Reserve and the Blackfoot people, my great-grandmother would smoke his lady's pipe and, you know, and he would she would tell us the weather. Looking at the birds, and today it still marvels me. I try and follow my grandmother. How did she tell weather? It's gonna rain 3 days, 4 days. It's gonna snow. It's gonna be windy. It's gonna be hot. And we're just young, me and my younger brother, Bill, and we looking at him and looking at the birds, how they sat on the branches of those trees. And I still marvel at that. I don't know where she got her gift, but like I say, it's beyond science. We embodied the bird world, the bird spirits, and science does not embody it. But as traditional Indigenous Blackfoot people, we embodied, that's how come all our ceremonies, you know, and I'll get to ceremonies, incorporates the bird world, the water world, sweet the beaks, the flying spirits, the buffalo, the four-legged, in those bundles. And I don't know if you people have ever been seen one or even heard of them, but we go way beyond science. And we've been doing this for thousands of years, could be 10,000 years old. Our connection to the bird world, the spirit world, and everything. So you imagine my great grandmother, all these being trees, and her sitting outside, either in the morning or in the evening, especially evening. And she would sit right by the door there, there's an old bench there. And she'd be smoking and looking at the trees. And she would say, those birds are talking to each other. They're visiting with each other. And sometimes the birds would just sit there, be quiet. And so I don't know if she measured how fast they're all talking, or one or two, if that's how she did the weather. How they were sitting, and these were small, you know, sparrows, six, how they were sitting. Backwards, facing the river, or this way, all the different branches. I think it'll take me 100 years to figure that out, you know, but she had a special gift. And I wish I asked her, but I was very young. She passed, and I was still kind of young, to tell her, Kikitaki. How do you tell, how do you know it's going to snow? I wish I was old enough to ask her, but I was just really young when she passed with all that knowledge. So continue. Okay. We talk about, you know, the birds, you know, migratory routes. I'm not here to stop this, no. I'm just one person. And we talk about the low numbers of birds, of bats, of everything, geese, you know, prairie chickens, sparrows, chickadees. This is just all on the west side of the Belly Buttes off the reserve, west of the standoff. And they're building more. On the left-hand side, I lost count 20 of these going up. And these, I think they're maybe close to 80, 100. And imagine how many birds will fly into these things, you know? And we probably won't get a proper count because whoever owns these probably won't allow us to go in there. And so when we talk about species on the decline, I just threw this in there. This is one cause out of many, you know. And again, we all, like this computer, we all need power, alternative resources. And I guess this is where we're stuck between a rock and a hard place. But with the flying species, this is what they're up against. If this was their pattern to go from the buttes or from the mountains or whatever, well, there's gonna be lots of these. You know, and they're coming up all over. It's not in just this area west of the Blood Reserve. There's a lot of these, and you know, I don't know how many right toward these big trucks and cranes. When they move away and they get going, how many birds are going to be on the ground there, you know? So that's just, I just wanted to use that. I'm not here to advocate for or against, but just to get the mind going. Okay, next one. And again, some more. And some more. You know, imagine if these were all right from east to west, from BC border to Saskatchewan border. I really wonder how many birds will maneuver through here, either fly lower or higher, but then, you know, it'd be interesting, you know. And, you know, I guess we're using the wind in southern Alberta and they're putting to good use, but, you know, there's pros and cons. That's all I'm going to say, pros and cons, but that's a lot of windmills. Next one. Okay, here's the ride. On the left side is my nephew, Will. There's five of us. I'm on the horse. You can see just the ears of my horse I'm riding. Look at the devastation of the Kino fire. And so in September, all that, I wonder how many birds weren't able to get out of there to go to if they do migrate, go to their wintering grounds in the river valleys, foothills, you know. And people, now there's a new term, they're calling them ghost trees, you know. You could see right to the mountains and you never saw a bird, never saw a bird. You know, and you know, it's interesting. And they told us we're not going to see bears, and we didn't. There was nothing to eat, the bears, nothing to eat. I didn't see eagle, hawks, bluebirds, all those species, did not see one. Then that valley I was mentioning between Lost Mountain and Mount Bowerman, up towards Twin Lakes, you know, even though there was greenery there, I think I only saw two birds. It was so quiet. It's like everything moved away, flew out, you know. And so this was a 7.5 hour ride, almost 30 kilometers past Red Rock Canyon, That's where we unloaded the horses. Then we left and we started climbing. And right at this spot, this is where I was, after I took this picture, I sang an honor song. And this is an ancient trail, 8,000-10,000 years old, you know. And, you know, so, you know, we followed that from the wolf trail to the deer, to the elk, to the buffalo, and teepee rings in there that were uncovered by this fire. So this was an amazing ride. I've always wanted to do it, and it was on my bucket list for a long time, and I finally did it, you know, rode up that way. And it's like riding from standoff to Fort McLeod or standoff to Carson. That's how far we rode, you know. And almost no birds on the left, and maybe one or two on the right, even with all the greenery that somehow, and the fires were on either side of this canyon or this valley. Next. Okay, I don't know if y'all know, load those other three pictures, but one I had, see, I'm pretty large on my screen. And
I think Sorica may have a couple more for you there, Mike.
Yeah, three more, because I want to end off on something here. And so this is after leaving Upper Twin Lake, or no, just going towards Twin Lake and still greenery. And we're going to the lake there. That's where we ate, and magnificent, but hardly any birds. The rest was burnt. And so this was last year, September. And this picture was taken about other rider behind me, and I was just kind of thinking, gee, this is where Blackfoot people, before modern horse crossed over continental divide, got their sweet pine, other animals traded with the Salish Kootenai, and so these are old trails, but now they're hiking trails. So you could walk this thing, and they'll advise you bring a tent or backpack and sleep overnight. Next one. Now look at that, you know, and this is coming back down. You know, you could see right through the mountains. There's no birds there, you know, so I don't know if there's a generation of birds lost, even the wolverines, they didn't go too deep. If they're able to go deep and they survive. You know, this Kino fire was, you know, just totally, I won't say in a negative way, it's a cleansing process. And so I won't be too negative about fire. Lightning started this and it more or less cleansed everything. And now maybe birds and animals need to regroup, new generation of animals and birds. You know, it's the path of you. The creator does these things, you know, even to the earth for a message, you know. And I got one more picture, then we'll go to a video. There's one picture of a dancer. And this is where I'll go a little bit deep, but I'm not gonna go. Here's a picture, 1928. I talked about the prairie chicken. This was from Ghana, this dancer. So imagine when I say we embodied, the story of the prairie chicken was this man went out to hunt way long, long ago and to feed his family. And he shot a prairie chicken and went home to feed his family. They're hungry. That night, the prairie chicken came to him. Why did you shoot me? And the man in the dream world said, I had to feed my family. We had no more food. And the prairie chicken said, I will show you this dance. And you're going to have to show this to all the men in the camp and your relatives, the men, to do this dance. And so that's where the prairie chicken dance started with the Blackfoots. Now, that's social dancing. Let me go a little bit further. And I didn't want to download anything because I got some videos. In Siksikai, they have a society. Gito Geeks, Prairie Chicken Society. It's still on today. And with all due respect, I'm not going to say too much. It is in their, deep into their cultural fabric, their cultural heritage of this society. Then I also have a picture, and I didn't want to put it on, of the pigeons, Gakweeks. I have a picture of 1924. My great uncle Dan Chief Moon, everybody thought he was all gospel. No, him and George First Rider when they're young, they're Gakweeks. And so, so here's the pigeons. We incorporated that because of a vision and a dream also to do a dance, but in a sacred way. And today it's still there. The other one is Kito Geeks. It's a young girl society from the Gani, the Chickadees, Kito Geeks. And so we have all these birds incorporated in our belief system, in our dream world, in our ceremony. And that's why I'm saying here is Western science. It doesn't even come close. We're way over there. And I'm not even hesitant to say that. I'm not even hesitant to say that when it comes to animals, we know animals as Blackfoot people. And so I wanted to kind of go with you, but I'm not going to explain it. And then these birds, you take the loon, chicks, all these other birds, they're in our bundles. And I'm not going to go too deep into that. They're in our bundles. And some of these are going to be opening their bundles next month. These are thousands of years old, these bundles. And so our stories are beyond Western philosophy, Western science. And that's what I'm saying. I don't want to be called a science. I'd rather be called just a Blackfoot knowledge holder. And even at that, I don't hold everything. You know, we're beyond that. And so it's, we've incorporated, we've embodied the spirit of these birds. And the last part I wanted to mention, my name, Ninapix, it means the eagle. All the other names in Blackfoot, four tribes that come from the flying spirits. It's part of our being. Birds and animals are not separate. We are all one, you know. And so I just want to end on this. I was trying to get a chicken dance song. We even have social songs that honors the chicken dance. And we sing it in powwows. And some of you have gone to powwows. So there's only 2 minutes. It's a good feeling song. And I just wanted you to listen to it. There's a chicken dance song. I just want to end up on that. I think I've given you a good journey. I will leave it up to you, for all of you, if you want to continue this journey on your own. But be respectful to Blackfoot elders. Be respectful to societies. No recording, no pictures. And you then you'll fully understand and you'll embrace when I say how much we know more than just Western science. So on that note, I thank all of you from the bottom of my heart for sharing this time, for listening to me. And I hope I made sense to you. I hope I was clear in my presentation. You know, we were first here. We've always been here, just like the birds and the buffalo. Those are our brothers and sisters. So I thank you for listening to me. I am Chief Bird, and I thank all of you. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, and also Alvin First Rider, for such a great presentation. We've got lots of nice comments in our chat box. People very much enjoyed and were inspired by your presentation and the knowledge that you have of the land that you can provide for us. So I think what I'll do is I can go through some of the questions which arise onto the chat box as best I can, and then you guys can try to answer them as you see fit. Let's see what we got here. They all popped up at once here. This is a question for Alvin. Do the monitoring cameras, are they always up all the time, or do you just put them up for certain seasons?
All the time, so we can get year-round data because there are resident birds and they will migrate into our area in the winter time. So yeah, year round. The geese, they're in the cultivated fields year round. So yeah, just being able to monitor that.
That's good to know. Thank you. There's a question, just scrolling back through here. Are there any stories related to the bison and the bees? And just flip through here, let's see here, where was that question? Oh yes, are there any stories of the relationship between bison and butterflies or bees?
Yeah, all the animals have a story, whether it's a Napi's story of creation, Namuik's, the bees. And again, like I said, these legend stories will go all night. Every animal, every flyer, every insect has a story. You know, they all have stories. And so imagine saying my grandfather's time, how much more stories there were, you know, and that's why I don't mind sharing. So the butterflies also had a story.
Thank you. Question for Alvin, I have a question, I guess, is that you mentioned kestrels on your landscape there, and some of the bird watchers I know are concerned about the numbers of kestrels dropping. Have you any thought or any experience with the numbers of kestrels in your area and whether they're going up or down?
Well, like I said, there seems to be a lot of incidental observations, especially around our north end, the Buffalo Range. There are quite a few that use that area. And I've actually seemed to think that that their populations are quite stable around here. Yeah, you could see a lot, especially during migration in the late August, just before harvest time. It seems like they hang out here with the harriers and the Swainsons, all waiting for fields to be combined.
Great, that's great to know that they're holding their own down in your area at least. There's a question that came on through the chat about the prairie chickens. It was inquiring about, are they extinct now in Alberta? And I guess there's some question between prairie chickens and sharp-tailed grouse. So the chicken dances that were illustrated, are those with the sharp-tailed grouse or are they with the prairie chicken?
Well, this is where Western science kind of differentiates. All of those are prairie chickens. Whatever type of grouses, because they all dance the same way, you know. But here, and again, the numbers, I don't see them where I live. Like, I just up the hill where I showed the log house. I don't see them anymore, and those are very rare. And I think there needs to be a count. I had a friend that up towards Kananaskis, this way, they said they saw some. So that's a rarity now. You know, I don't know how many prairie chickens and the different type of grouses. It sounds like they've been the prairie grouse has almost been pushed into the tree area, you know, into the bush. You know, the only other place that somebody mentioned that they saw a prairie chicken dance and the different type of grouses was over in Saskatchewan at the Grassland National Park. And John Chief Moon was just telling me up south someplace they saw some. So they're sparse now in the reserve. They're still there, but not as abundant how they used to be.
So yeah, from our monitoring, we do find pockets, leks of sharp tail sage grouse. We're kind of, from fragmentation, their range doesn't reach this far anymore. But we're hoping with the reintroduction of Ini that starts attracting species that weren't here. We've recently had antelope migrate that haven't been here for decades. And so it's looking promising. But yeah, we do have some grouse species on the reserve that we've identified and monitored.
Great. A question came up Can you recommend any published material on traditional Blackfoot stories?
Go ahead, Alvin. Go ahead.
There is a online resource, like an online library, and but I'll let Mike talk to this.
I'm just looking at my collection. There is books. You go online, you go on Amazon, you go on Google, you're going to find a lot of books. So, you know, with your own research, you'll find them. And I can't go through my 30 books here. There's books on Blackfoot stories, the Napi stories, the creation stories, when the sun came down, people before the park, just to name a few, and I could go on and on. Just go under Blackfoot books or stories, it'll all come up.
Perfect, thank you for that. This is a question for Anita Pixky. There was a question about Chief Bird, your name, and where did that come from?
That was given to be my elder. And again, you know, it's not like any Dick, Jane, and Bob, and Harry, and whatever. Our names go through ceremony, and I was given the name by an elder. And in terms of me, I did a Blackfoot gift offering. I gave food, some money, tobacco, and I gave two horses for my name. In the white world, you'll never see that. Nobody gives horses for a name. And so this, I mean, you know, everybody's kind of first, second, third, fourth year settler generation here. And that's why I wanted to come here. Southern Alberta, but I'm just speaking for Southern Alberta. There's got to be a crossover understanding. We always been here and we have our ways. And this came through a naming ceremony. And so large urban centers, they have to begin to respect and understand where we're coming from. So Ninapik, see, the old man said, this old man, I was going to pull out the book earlier. I found my name, 1780. Imagine, Ninapik, see. And Lori Poon said, this name is really old. And way back then, who had it was very powerful. And so to me, we go through a whole naming ceremony, and I don't know if people have witnessed it here. That's what we're trying to create, an understanding of how we do things versus the first Christianized names, government names, and what have you. That name, there's no ceremony. In our Blackfoot names, very, very elaborate spiritual ceremony. And it's really cool.
Thanks. One question comes up, or a comment, related to the use of pesticides such as Roundup and the impact it could have on kestrels and other types of birds. So I guess that brings up a question. Is that something you're seeing in your area there, Alvin? Or also, is the Blackfoot, in your nation, is it using any sort of pesticides, or do you have a pesticide protocol in terms of using herbicides and things like that?
We do follow best management practices on the reserve. We do try to use integrated pest management when controlling invasives or anything like that. For the farmers, it's all dependent on the fields and what their inputs are. So being able to monitor and watch those, helps contribute to our overall goals. And fragmentation is huge, right? It has a huge impact on grassland birds, and being able to provide these little islands of habitat for them, or protecting these little fringe areas, or whatever we can do to help help these species recover.
Perfect. We have one question, which has sort of been answered a bit, but there's a question about where to go in Southern Alberta to experience Blackfoot culture.
I just wrote three quick things there. You know, Head smashed in west of Fort McLeod. They have a good presentation. Blackfoot Historical Center in Siksikai, you know, Blackfoot Crossing and riding on Stone Provincial Park. You know, that's just three, but you have to go out, you know, and ask questions. If you ask those people that work there, they'll in turn give you more direction, you know. And one place you to start from is just a social thing. Go to the powwows of all the three Blackfoot reserves. You'll make a lot of connections. You have to go out. It's not going to come to you.
One question is related to that. Is the general public welcome at powwows?
Everybody's welcome, even Martians.
good one. let's see. I make a little comment related to the relationship with the bison and the bird, particularly the sharp-tailed grouse. Up in Nose Hill in Calgary, we used to have a dancing ground, a lek, up on Nose Hill. This would be about in the 1990s, the early 1990s. They no longer dance there anymore. Lots of people going up there probably disturbing them. But related to that, back in the 1970s, I saw a report done in the University of Calgary about possibly bringing back bison to the top of Nose Hill, introducing them to Nose Hill. So that might be an interesting experiment to introduce them to Nose Hill and see what impact it will have on the bird populations there.
Yeah. Can I just add a quick story? Something I've been reading my phone. We quickly go back to names, how the world is different. We're all Blackfoot speakers when we were kids in grade one. Nobody spoke English. I didn't even know my name was Mike, tell you the truth. So we're all lined up and the teacher asked the first guy, "Take it down, what's your name?" And Gordon was kind of small. He said, "Gordon, and your name?" All, I think 18 of us, including the eight girls, all our name, we all said Gordon, Gordon, Gordon. I even said Gordon. Those 18 Gordons, because we didn't even know our English name. We just copycat him. Oh, you know. And so we're asking, what did the teacher say? And we're all going like this. I don't know. So we just followed Gordon. So those 18 Gordons, and the teacher didn't catch on. In his attendance book, she wrote 18 Gordons. You know, holy cow. You know, it was only later. Oh, that teacher asked her your name. And my childhood name was Natoy Munis, Sacred Otter, before I got my adult name. Oh, okay. Because I told my mother, "What's my name?" "Michael." We named ourselves Gordon. So those 18 Gordons, and the teacher wrote 18 Gordon names. So I don't know who was confused then.
Good story. Here's a question, Alvin. So with all this reintroduction of the bison and your monitoring of them, is there going to be some information or results published in the future that people can look at to see what the success is of the reintroduction of the bison?
Oh, yeah, we'll be sharing our results and everything. We're extensively looking at monitoring everything from the soil, the beetles, the nest use, and just look at the interactions that the Ini are having on the landscape, and the overall health of the landscape, doing range health assessments. When they do move down to riparian health assessments, and just monitoring all the interactions, the changes that are happening on the landscape. And it will be shared.
Sounds pretty good. One question just popped up. Is there anything else you can tell us about the management of the bison? Will they be finished on grass and harvested for food, or left as a wild herd where the calves are left to left with their mothers?
They will be managed as a wild herd, but eventually a herd that the tribe can use culturally, spiritually, and holistically. they're meant to be on the landscape, the hill, our people, and the connection to Ini in Blackfoot is, like Mike said, is we are one and the same. And being able to expose our youth to that and being able to see the herd grow, there's endless opportunities.
Yeah, and if I can add to that, you know, there's three sacred buffalo horn societies, Sky Kana and Browning of Sky Pikani. And those are very old societies and honoring the buffalo plus the other animals. So Sonny mentioned, you know, the buffalo is incorporated in about everything with all the tribes. And again, you know, you get the right connections, people will show you around as long as you don't abuse it.
Sounds good. I guess a note from Kathleen. Could you mind touching again on the importance of us for planting of those plants that are natural in Alberta? I'm not sure what you're getting at there, Kathleen. I don't know if you could verbalize that.
Utilizing native species in your gardens, like in your lawns, trying to contributes overall to the overall insect health, which has a ripple effect up the food chain to the birds, bees, the species that evolved with this landscape. They should be used in gardens and used in their holistically, their medicines. Some of them are viewed as weeds, but they're cleansing medicines, or you know, and just looking at it from a different perspective than a nice Kentucky bluegrass lawn. Look at it from a holistic perspective and try to incorporate native seeds and allowing them to grow and mature. And then, yeah, okay, I think that's what she was getting at.
I think so too, yeah. And it's something that a lot of us in Calgary are starting to look toward, is to naturalize our spaces that we have here.
The Old Man Watershed Council, they do a lot with urban planners, and they help plan native landscape gardens in the urban area, urban settings.
Oh, okay. That's good to know.
Yeah, the one piece that I think was a little bit confusing is, I think that's important for gardeners to know, is that sometimes greenhouses will advertise grown in Alberta, which we might mistake as meaning it was native to Alberta, but it might actually be an introduced plant that was cultivated here, so it'll survive here, but we just have to be careful when we're asking for plants that it actually originated as an Alberta plant, I believe. That was one of the next ones, so people were aware. I think I'm correct on that, but do feel free to correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, the introduction of species can have a negative effect. Got leafy spurge, knapweed, Kentucky bluegrass, all the agronomic species are the seed mixes from the ditches, that weren't naturally here. They're just out competing our natural grasses and causing a monoculture of ecosystems that is not good for the landscape. Our landscapes are diverse, they're mosaics, and we need to be able to allow our natural landscapes to kind of interact that way as a mosaic.
Mm-hmm. Well, question, I guess, is just a clarification. When are the buffalo going to be reintroduced onto the Blood Reserve?
They already are. They were just reintroduced this past February. There's a herd on the north end. So we're monitoring. We've done the pre-monitoring, and now we'll be doing the monitoring. Yeah.
Okay. How many were there, and where did they come from?
Elk Island, and there's 40 of them.
Yeah, and you could go to Kainai Ini rematriation on YouTube. You'll hear Alvin. He did an excellent job on that. So you could pick it up on YouTube and see the Ini being loaded and all. Really good story.
That was a huge collective effort from years and years of work of everybody. Leroy Little Bear, Amethyst, our elders, people that have passed on, and Blood Tribe land management personnel, and it's just, too many people to name, but it's been, it just goes to show what, if collectively, if we put our minds together, what we could accomplish, and it's healing and it's helping our landscape.
Sounds like a great, great program. Are there any incentive programs to take place to help take back and naturalize tribal leased lands?
So, can you say that again?
Yeah, so I got a question. Are there any incentive programs in place to help take back and naturalize tribal leased lands?
Yeah, that's a good question, very political. It's up to political leadership to change this around. Alvin, how much what's the percentage of cultivated land on the reserve?
Oh man, it's a lot, like two-thirds. Yeah. About
two-thirds, 80%. And where I live, a few minutes from the Buffalo, here, the north end of where I live, sparse parcels in the south, in between, not much grassland. And so that is a very politically loaded question, because, farmers, they're all permit farmers. They're not native. They take out roughly 25 million out of the reserve. And we're left behind measly. I don't know. That's a very political question.
I just have one comment, though. We do have one land occupant, William Singer, that has worked with Blood Tribe Land Management on restoring back agriculture land back into native prairie. It's around the wetland, and it started with the buffer system, and he just is slowly increasing that buffer system to where he eventually has a plan that he wants to restore all his land back to native prairie. So there is that possibility. It's just, like Mike said, it's, I don't know.
We're still fighting for what's left of grassland. We're fighting for that. No cultivation.
We're having the same problem in Calgary. We do have some native prairie scattered here and there within the city limits, which is always under threat from development. So we're fighting the same battle that you guys are doing as well. And probably that's occurring right across the prairies, I would think. One question. With the mapping that Alvin showed us, is there provincial-wide mapping of all land that is being returned to or is remaining as native grasslands?
I think they're individual organizations, but I'm not sure if there is an actual whole map of that's pretty broad, like a huge scale.
Yeah,
I think you're correct,
Alvin.
I think there is knowledge out there about where the native prairie is and what's happening to it to some degree.
Yeah, there is a map, but I don't know where to locate it. I actually saw it of the remaining grasslands and all the cultivated land in the province up to the tree line. I just forget to put that out. This was about 2 years ago. And it's like the grasslands are just shrinking and shrinking and shrinking because of development and what have you.
Yeah, there's actually, I know who it is. The Prairie Conservation Forest. Yes. They have the State of the Prairie document, and it talks about the landscape in Alberta and Alberta's parkland area.
Another question related to the grasslands is, Can you name one or two species that are really reliant on grasses for nesting and feeding?
Really reliant on grasses for nesting and feeding. Well, I guess from bison perspective, it's been documented in a couple studies where the red wing blackbird utilized their hair with their mixture of nests, whatever they're using, their materials. I'm not sure. I've never really looked into nests. I'm not that familiar with nesting. I try not to disturb nests, actually. I just view from afar and when they're not in occupancy. But the species that are monitoring are like the Sprague's pipit, burrowing owls, species at risk, and trying to find the best way to protect their habitat, what they like. We do have a lot of Sprague's pipits on the reserve.
Great. One question related for Alvin is, can you compare any differences between Western and Blackfoot ecology? What would you say as the most important distinguishing factors and methods between Western and Blackfoot ecology?
Well, like Mike said, it's more, Blackfoot is more it's in the experience and it's interactive and you're learning as you're living. You're learning through culture and you're learning through the experience of being involved in the culture. And then Western science, it just has its strict ways, right? Just the way you go, the way you go about it, the way you collect data and the way you report it. And it's very categorical and yeah, it's like, I don't know. I try to walk in the two worlds the best I can, and being able to use them. The holistic management plan was a good example of how using the best of both worlds was able to create that management plan. But yeah. I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah, it certainly sounds like you and your colleague are combining maybe the best of both, perhaps, in terms of managing your landscape, particularly with bringing back the bison. One more question, then we'll wrap it up. I had asked if kestrel's populations are affected by pesticides and Roundup. DDT was also damaging. How about currently used chemicals?
Well, they're supposed to be heavily regulated in Alberta, right? Like everything's supposed to fall under strict guidelines, strict, and it's supposed to be monitored through. I'm not sure what the chemical registry agency is, but it's supposed to be monitored through that, and then just being able to. Monitor what's being inputted through soil analysis and being able to identify if there is an effect that's happening on the landscape through pesticides to herbicides. So I guess the question would be to identify if there is the problem and then figuring out that solution. It's always about finding that solution and about restoring balance back into the landscape.
That's a great, great comment for sure. With that, our last question, I would just like to wrap up here a little bit. First of all, I would very much like to thank our presenters, Napitsky and Alvin, for their great insight on the Blackfoot perspective and view about the landscape and the importance of birds. I also would like to thank Kelly for her land acknowledgement at the beginning of the program. And certainly the Calgary Public Library for hosting this event. It was very much appreciated. And I certainly would like to thank all the attendees who attended tonight's presentation, and hope you got a lot of good knowledge and information to take back with you to further explore Blackfoot view on the world. And with that, I'd like to say happy spring. And just a reminder, tonight is Earth Hour. So 8:30 to 9:30, people are encouraged to turn off the lights, step outside, enjoy the night air, and appreciate the Naha, our Mother Earth. So thanks a lot for all attending.
Yeah, just wanted to thank everybody for, tuning in. And I did receive the tobacco and the pouch. I really appreciate that. So to all the, guests on that, thank you very much. I threw in my my email, chiefbird@hotmail.com. We're going to continue the conversation. Sometimes you just can't say everything. And so I'm willing to correspond with people if they want to correspond with me. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Me too. I just want to thank everybody for listening, and thanks for the invitation for sharing this this opportunity to share our knowledge and share what we have to share. And I look forward to all the work that everybody's doing, and I hope Calgary's designation goes through. And yeah, if you guys, I have social media, and my email is, I'll type it if you guys want to stay in touch.
Thank you so much, and to everyone here. It's a real honor. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Have a good evening.
Wonderful. Thank you, everyone.